Note that next week is a joint service. It's our annual picnic with Kurt Ball and Roxanne.
We want to have an open and inviting space. We want to keep this space sacred. We We want to honor our history, keep things aesthetically pleasing, have a space for the choir and myself and Sharon. We want to consider those people that might want to use this space for weddings or funerals or other special events, and also consider the space with acoustics and sound microphone setup. So what we're really looking to do is leveling out this space right here. But we have to have some considerations to do when we're thinking about this. So the wainscoting, which is this right here, we don't know how deep it really goes, but we have some ideas. We want to consider there's a central back here, historic symbols, lighting, electrical speakers, Wi-Fi, the carpet, budget limitations, projector screen on the wall, which I think we all really like, and then some accessibility. So this is not set in stone, it's just sort of something that we're proposing to the board, and what we sort of, with all these considerations, they might be the best possible idea, but we're considering other ideas as well. What we want to do is remove all of the levels up here, except for the one level, which is this step right here. Keep this particular step, but and then keep it flat, the whole thing. So get rid of this level, and another level over there. Possibly install a ramp so that there is a full accessibility here. Move the piano to the front of the choir, so we've pretty much done that, just to see if that works. And, like, for me, it's feeling pretty good. I want to check with Sharon. Also, reduce the number of chairs in the choir. Remove the front pew to the far left side to increase space for the children. So we want to move the children's area back over here. I think it's a little bit better for them. Remove the clutter and try and clean up the space a little bit, and then keep the historical symbols as best as we can. Just a few risks and issues. Some electrical changes might have to be made. The wainscoting, the ducts are come right up to this level, so we have to think about that. Carpet, we say we can't, we can get the carpet, and the budget. So we haven't really drawn up a budget, right? This is still in the, you know, the thinking stages. So our next steps are alternative ideas, and there are some drawings being made. So we're getting that, get a risk written estimate of the we're considered and propose the budget to the board and decide, oh, the electrical panel. So that's just a thought that we might need to upgrade the electricity, and that may or may not be within the scope of the project. I think we're sort of thinking it's not at this point. So that's my presentation. If you have any questions, you can ask anyone on the committee, or ideas, you can come to any of us as well. I know there's drawings being drawn up. So if you have any questions, I'm available, and other people are available after the service. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily, for your work on that. And here, I'll get this back up again. Our announcement's being done. We have a lighter price candle. Okay. Oh, Marty has an announcement, sorry. And who's for lighting the price candle?
Thanks to whoever left this baby bottle here. That's a useful prop. So thank you for participating in the fundraiser for Cambridge Pregnancy Center. And if you brought your bottles in, and you have them with you, just put them on the table at the bottom of the stairs. There's a box with some bottles. It's kind of overflowing, but that's a good place to leave them. So thank you.
We light our Christ candle now to represent the light of Christ that shines in the world. I say to you, peace be with you.
And also with you.
Our opening hymn is Be Thou.
Thank you.
grow. Open our spirit so that your own spirit might move over us and within. Let our worship be worthy. Let our praise be wholehearted. Let our hymns be sincere. Let our prayer be honest as we give ourselves again into your care and keeping. Amen. Let us pray. God, whom we call Father, bless us this day as we worship. May we feel your presence with us, guiding us, lifting us up, easing our sorrows, comforting our worries, and bringing us together into one community of faith. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And our invitation to confession. Part of our worship together is acknowledging that we sin and fall short of the glory of God. Let us open ourselves up to God's mercy and grace. Let us take time in silence to examine our hearts and minds and search for the wisdom and the strength we need to love ourselves and our neighbors as God calls us. Assurance come from Psalm 86. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call on you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my cry of supplication. In the day of trouble, I call on you, for you will answer me. I invite you now to join in singing. Who is the oldest person to told you when you were a baby. Then you're going to do some math. Who was the oldest person to hold them? How far back does that take you? Just think about it and maybe share that with someone. Who was the oldest person to hold you? Share with someone next to you. I'll give you a minute or two to talk about it.
First reading is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5, verses 6 through 17, and I'm reading from the Good News Bible. So we are always full of courage. We know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord's home. For our life is a matter of faith, not of sight. We are full of courage, and would much prefer to leave our home in the body and be at home with the Lord. More than anything else, however, we want to please Him, whether in our home, here, or there. For all of us must appear before Christ to be judged by Him. Everyone will receive whatever he or she deserves according to everything they have done, good or bad, in their bodily life. We know what it means to fear the Lord, and so we try to persuade others. God knows us completely, and I hope that in your hearts you know me, that's Paul, as well. We are not trying again to recommend ourselves to you. Rather, we're trying to give you a reason to be proud of us, so that you will be able to answer those who boast about a person's appearance more than their character. Are we really insane? It is for God's sake, or are we sane? Then it is for your sake. We are ruled by the love of Christ. Now that we recognize that one man died for everyone, which means that they all share in his death. He died for all, so that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but only for him who died and was raised to life for their sake. No longer, then, do we judge anyone by human standards. Even if at one time we judged Christ according to human standards, we no longer do so. When anyone is joined to Christ, he is a new being. The old is gone, the new has come. And the second reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 to 34. This is the parable of a grown seed. Jesus went on to say, "The kingdom of God is like this. A man scatters seed in his fields. He sleeps at night. He's up and about during the day, and all the while the seeds are sprouting and growing. Yet he doesn't know how it happens. The soil itself makes the plants grow and bear fruit. First the tender stalk appears, then the head, and finally the head full of grain. When the grain is ripe, the man starts cutting it with his scythe or sickle, because harvest time has come." And then the parable of the mustard seed. "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like?" asked Jesus. "What parable shall we use to explain it?" "It's like this. A man takes a mustard seed, the smallest seed in the entire world, and plants it in the ground. After a while, it grows up and becomes the biggest of all plants. It puts out such large branches that birds come and make their nests in its shade." Jesus preached his message to the people, using stories and many other parables like these. He told them as much as they could understand. He would not speak to them without using parables, but when he was alone with his disciples, he would explain everything to them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
faith, not by sight. Parenting is like that. We can't fully see the path that our child's life will take. We have to have faith that our children will grow, and they will learn, and they will live happy lives. That is every father's hope. Fathers create safe spaces for their children. A Garden of Eden, a fenced yard, a gated community. No matter what we do, though, no matter how hard we try to keep suffering out, it finds a way in. And like a father who is ready to pick up a fallen child, God is there ready to help. Now, the Buddha, who as a young man, before he became known as the Buddha, he was called Siddhartha, his father tried to protect him and tried to direct his path in life. Now, the Buddha was raised by his father. His mother died shortly after he was born. And his father was a king. And when a holy man went to his father and said to him, "Your son will either become a great king or military leader." And the Buddha's father said, "Oh, great, that's wonderful. I really, really like that." And then the holy man said, "Wait a minute, he might also become a holy man, a spiritual leader." And the king said, no, I don't like that. No. That would be a hard life, and he'd see suffering, and he'd be poor, and I don't want that for him. So the father decided to kind of create an environment where he thought if he created an environment where if his son didn't see any suffering and didn't learn anything about religion, then he wouldn't become a holy man. So what he did is he made sure that all the servants in the palace, he lived in a beautiful palace, all the servants were young and healthy. His son didn't ever see anyone who was old or sick or frail. He wasn't even allowed to see flowers that wilted. Everything looked perfect. Now you think that Siddhartha would be happy, but he wasn't. He felt somehow something wasn't right, and he longed to know what was life like outside the palace walls. So one day he convinced a servant to take him outside the palace gates, and he was shocked by what he saw. He saw a man with lines all over his face. He was all bent over, had trouble walking, and he said, "What is wrong with that man?" And his servant said, "All people eventually get old." And then Siddhartha saw a man who was covered in red sores all over his body, and he looked like he was in terrible pain. And Siddhartha said to his servant, "What's wrong with that man?" And he said, "Well, some people get sick." And then they passed a body lying on the ground. And as they passed it, there was a terrible smell. And Siddhartha said, "What's wrong with that man?" And his servant said, "Unfortunately, he died. All people eventually die." Siddhartha was shocked. He had trouble taking it in. They went along a little further, and then Siddhartha saw a holy man. And this man was very thin and wore rags, and he looked very poor. But he had this beautiful, contented, serene expression on his face. And Siddhartha said to his servant, "What is this man's story?" And his servant said, "Well, this is a holy man, and he has given up all worldly goods and all worldly ambition so that he can avoid the suffering and fear in the world." Well, this was attractive to Siddhartha, who had just seen suffering for the first time. He certainly wanted to find a way to avoid it and to help other people to avoid suffering. So he decided that he would leave the palace forever and he would become a holy man. And despite all his father's efforts, that's what he did. And he later became known as the Buddha. Siddhartha had grown up in a magic kingdom, a 6th-century Disneyland, gates closed to all the other parts of life. But Siddhartha's father was to learn that you can't shut out the world. Now, I was speaking with a father recently who told me that he had gone through a rough time. His father, his family had gone through a rough time. He was having a hard time at work. His boss wasn't happy with his work. There was a risk that he might lose his job if he didn't meet certain quotas. One of his daughters was being bullied at school, and his mother was ill, so he had to make frequent trips to help her out. So the family was stressed out. They thought, well, let's go somewhere where we can forget about all the stress of life, get away from this suffering around us. Let's go to the Magic Kingdom. So you can guess where they went. They went to Disneyland. And they were thrilled. His daughters were really happy, excited about seeing princesses and castles, and if you've been there, everything looks beautiful and perfect, and it's just a wonderful place to go. Well, he and his family were all sitting on Main Street, USA, and they were watching a parade go by with acrobats tumbling, dancers twirling. There was a band playing. When suddenly, they heard a cry for help, and they could see through the spaces in between the parade that a man had collapsed onto the ground. They saw the parade kept on going, the music kept on playing, the dancers kept on dancing, and then a team of paramedics came, and they wound their way through the crowd and went over to the man and lifted him up onto the stretcher. The magic of the Magic Kingdom was broken. Things like that weren't supposed to happen in Disneyland. So he said a prayer, because he was confident that wherever suffering was, God would find a way to help. Where there's suffering, the Father sends the Son, and Jesus finds a way in. Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free." Freedom for the prisoners. A famous prisoner died this week. Anyone familiar with who that was? Stephen Reed? Stopwatch Gang? I thought Bill might know that. They were famous bank robbers in the 70s and 80s. So he was famous for two things, for being a bank robber and a famous writer. Reed served 20 years in a place where suffering is shut in rather than shut out. And that's where he came to find his second unlikely career as a writer. He's a beautiful writer. His books are amazing. And Susan Musgrave, who is a famous Canadian poet, read one of his books. I think it was Jackrabbit Parole. And she fell in love with a writer, and then later fell in love with a man. They ended up getting married while he was still in prison, and when he was out, they had a wonderful life together. They had two daughters. They had 12 great years where they were the literary it couple of Vancouver. And it was great. Until one day, after a slow kind of decline, Stephen Reed fell back into his old addiction, which had caused all the trouble in the first place. He followed a friend to his house and thinking he was going to catch up with his old friend, but really caught up with an old habit. And before long, he walked into a bank and he tried to rob it. This time, Reed was given an 18-year sentence. His daughter, Sophie, always made him Father's Day cards every year, homemade ones. And she was making him a card on the day she found out that he wouldn't be coming home. It broke his heart to think of his daughter's suffering. It broke his heart so much that he said he might just take himself off the camp, which is, I guess, prison lingo for he just might find a way to end it all. He felt so bad. He went to talk to the prison psychiatrist, who told him words that changed his life. He said, "This isn't about you anymore. You've had your life. You're going to prison for a long time. This is about a 10-year-old girl. You have to show her that no matter how badly you screw up your life, you can survive, maybe even find redemption. That is the one gift you have left to give." This is the gift that the Father gives us in Jesus Christ. The knowledge that no matter what we have done, no matter what the world says we are, or how badly that we feel about ourselves, we are forgiven, we are loved, we are redeemed, saved by our Father's love. Reed said that his daughter, who would continue to give him Father's Day cards throughout his sentence, his daughter's love was so strong that it jumped over the prison walls and right through the razor wire into his heart and kept him going. And that's how strong the love of our God is. There are no walls built strong enough to shut it out. God loves us no matter what, and God will always find a way.
Thank you.
And now, it's the invitation for offering. We give in hope, we give in love, we give because God calls us to give. In Jesus' name, we pray. Your offering will now be received. invite you now to join in singing This Is God's Wondrous Word. But it's because Father's Day, we're saying this is my Father's Word.
Sure.
Yes, it's the same word. They just changed it in the new version to make it more, I guess, gender neutral. But today we can say this is my Father's Word.
Can I just ask the dads at the end of the service to come up and if I can take their picture with these beautiful flowers at the end of the service, I'll put it on Facebook. But if you don't want your picture taken, that's okay too.
Prepare to receive a blessing from our Father, our Creator.